When possible, I live in private homes. That is the only way I can get the quiet and rest I must have in my work.
Sit down, Prince. I guess you're right. A young fellow in your line must find it hard to get a little rest.
Guess a body can get rest if they want it.
I prefer lovely people, comfortable homes, and rest. When I am fortunate enough to get in such a beautiful home as yours, Mrs. Wilson, Allah has blessed me.
Well, now, it's nice to know you believe in someone, or Allah, as you call him.
We call him Allah. You call him... What does it matter? I don't think he minds as long as we know he is supreme and the only one we can trust.
I've trusted him all my life, and he hasn't failed me yet.
Why don't you men sit over there? I want to clear the table.
Yes, dear. Come, Prince.
Miss Wilson should hurry, or else she'll miss the first of the show.
Might as well sit down. Fretting won't help. She'll be down as soon as she's ready.
Wouldn't make any difference, would it, as Larry, when you go on?
Oh, of course. I want her to enjoy the show.
Prince, I want to ask you a question. You know a father is always very anxious about his daughter.
After a mother has raised her.
We are very fond of our child. I had noticed, that is, we know that you and Margaret have been spending most of your time together. And I should like to know, that is, well, I would like to ask...
What are my intentions towards your daughter? Also my future plans? Is that it, Mr. Wilson?
That's just what I wanted to say.
Well, my plans for the future are very definite. When I have made sufficient money, I will settle down in one of the smaller towns and open a little business of my own. Then, I shall marry.
Naturally, you will marry a girl of the theater.
I had hoped Margaret... I mean, Miss Wilson and I could reach an understanding.
Margaret has already done as she pleases in matters of this kind.
Pa, you know, she always comes to us before deciding anything so important.
When had you planned on reaching this understanding?
Really, there's no cause for alarm. Miss Wilson will have plenty of time to consider the matter.
We love our daughter very deeply. Should she be made unhappy, I'm sure we could not stand it.
Our little girl is all we have. Please don't go on with this make-believe, if that's what it is.
Now, Mother, the young folks will take care of themselves. My boy, you're all right.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Your daughter will be assured of my sincerity before making her choice. My family has always insisted that the sons marry into, well, should I say, comfortable circumstances. But I am sure they will take my feelings into consideration.
Wait a minute, young man. My daughter will not be a pauper when she...
Alfred, Paul, you go ahead. I see you're all set to talk too much.
She always says I talk too much. Now about Margaret. We've been saving a surprise for her. A fine piece of East Texas land as a wedding present.
Property is more of a liability than an asset.
This piece has been in our family for many years. The famous East Texas oil structure runs right through it. I'll show you on the map. Mom put the box way back in the drawer, and I couldn't see it at first. We always keep it in our dresser. Oh, here's the deed. Free and clear. An oil company offered me $15,000 cash, $30,000 in oil, and 1/8 royalty. Here's the map. Now, this is the East Texas oil structure. So much red built around it, you can't grow anything but sagebrush. Gushes had come in on both sides of my land at better than 30,000 barrels a day.
This is a valuable piece of land. Why don't you develop it?
We decided to keep it until Margaret marries and let her enjoy what it will bring with her husband. You see, Prince, Ma and I don't need much.
Margaret will be down in a minute. Paul, what does all this mean?
Well, I was just showing the Prince I've let place down in Texas.
I wish you hadn't done this. I wanted... Oh, well, I guess. I'm sorry, Prince Alihabad, but I just don't like to brag.
I can assure you Mr. Wilson was not bragging. Just a little show of paternal pride.
No, Margaret, I came to see you.
Gee, you look pretty. Where are you going?
I'm going to the theater with a friend.
Not with him. I won't let you.
But when did you assume the role of a dictator?
Call me what you like, but I wanted to go out with that phony.
Well, at least he has a backbone.
Yeah, for your money.
Take long now, did it?
It seemed like hours to me, but I suppose it was really only a couple of minutes.
Whoever that was that tried to take the door off the hinges.
It was Buster, Paul.
Yes. You see, Prince, here is where we keep all of our valuables. They're perfectly safe there.
And naturally, you keep the key securely put away.
Never had a key, and we've never lost nothing out of that box.
We must be going, or you will miss the show.
I've got the show with me. So how can I miss? Good night, Mommy and Dad. I'll be right home.
Good night to you both.
Good night.
Have a good time. He seems to be a fine young fellow.
Oh, I guess so. But I have the queerest feeling like... something's going to happen.
Now, Ma, you always get those notions when you're tired. You'd better go to bed early and get a good night's rest. You'll feel better in the morning.
I hope so. I wish you hadn't shown him these things.
Don't worry. Everything will be all right.
I'm so disappointed, I don't know what to do. Our boy works so hard, and you don't do a thing to help him.
Don't start that all over again. I want to read the paper.
You're always talking about what good friends you have in politics, yet you do nothing for your own. Why don't you get him on some of these big cases?
Men that handle those big cases are usually working for the government or the police department.
I'm waiting for Mr. Hoover to get a case where he needs a fingerprint expert. Then I shall go to Washington.
Well, I know he will appreciate you.
I opened the office for him fully equipped, and that's all I can do.
My dear, I do think an awful lot of you.
Prince, darling.
You should have traveled to all the pretty places in the world as the wife of Prince Alihabad. You shall know New York, London, Paris, Buenos Aires, all the pretty places where one really lives.
I'm just a small town girl. You might be ashamed of me.
Alihabad will never be ashamed of the woman he loves.
Will you always feel that way?
Always, my dear.
I was never so happy before. Only, you're going so soon.
Then you will go with me in the morning. Your happiness must be lasting. You will pack a few things at once. I must leave quite early.
Thank
Margaret Wilson. Oh, hello, Margaret. Can you come over at once? Honey, what's the matter?
Mother, it's something terrible.
Well, what's happened, child? Hello? Margaret? Hello? Something's wrong at the Wilson. Margaret started to tell me, but her voice faded dead away.
We better go right up there.
Junior,
you wait here. If there's anything you can do, I'll call you. You hear?
Yes, goodbye, Mama.
Lingley talking.
Hey, why don't you come on down here so I can get in the office?
Who are you hollering at?
I'm hollering at you. You ought to have been down here and had the office open. Suppose we get some business.
You better quit hollering in my ears.
It's my nickel. I can holler if I want to.
What number do you want?
Never mind what number I want. I want to talk to you.
Well, you can't talk to me, Sonny, till you get my number.
Sonny? Boy, who you calling Sonny? You know what number I want.
Got your party?
Yes, I got my party operator.
You ain't got your party till you get the right number.
I want 486.
That's the wrong number. If you want to talk to me, Sonny, call 468.
The time is up. The clock is 5 minutes.
Oh.
That phone's been busy for 10 minutes.
Well, call again.
468, please. Oh, here he is now. Hello? Junior, we need an expert at once. You better bring all your things and come as fast as you can. Now, I guess you can call the police.
Hello, operator. Emergency. Get me the police. Hello, Chief. This is Ernest Lingley. Send some men up to the Wilson home at once. It's been a murder. Yeah.
At the scene of the crime.
We know all about these. Can't we take them and say we found them there?
How you gonna get them fingerprints off the paper? Come on, let's hurry. We'll be too late.
We ain't gonna miss nothing. Whatever it is happened by now.
Where have you been so long? Hurry up. All the good clues will be gone before you get started.
Tell us what happened, Mama. We don't know what to look for.
Don't you know what's happened? Mr. Wilson's been murdered. That's what's happened.
Murdered? In the middle of the night?
No, in the middle of the day. Oh, it was terrible.
It must have been. Yes, ma'am. Worse than that.
Got him, Langley. You get the handcuffs.
Hold him, partner. Hold him still a minute. I'll get his fingerprints.
What was you doing under that bed?
What did you kill him for?
You've been hiding now all the time and just not trying to make you get away.
What's your name? Come on, what's your name?
Sergeant Ramsey.
Did you say your name was Sergeant something?
Yes, Detective Sergeant Ramsey, homicide detail.
I guess my partner made a little mistake.
Wait a minute now. You know we partners and everything.
Now, don't start that. You hollered, I got him. And I was only doing my duty.
Now, just a minute, you. Now, I'll ask a few questions. What's your name?
Who, me?
Yes, you.
Oh.
Oh, what?
Just plain old.
Is O your full name?
No, sir. There ain't even an O in his name.
You'll be quiet. I'll get to you in a minute.
Take your time, Sergeant. No hurry.
Now, what's your name?
Lingley.
Well, why didn't you say so in the first place? You sit down there while I ask your partner a few questions.
Hello, Pop. I was just looking for you. Are you sure Mr. Wilson's dead?
That's what the doctor said. Why?
I just sat on the bed and he kicked me.
Ernest, is this your boy?
Yes, sir, Sergeant. This is my son. Mr. Wilson was such a good friend of the family that the chief gave him permission to work on the case. We like to help out all we can, you know.
Yeah, he'll be a lot of help.
Sergeant, come here a minute. The lady's able to talk now, and we've got a suspect.
Now, Miss Wilson, will you tell us just what happened?
There isn't much that I can tell. Last night, I felt as if someone came into my room. I tried to awaken, but I couldn't. And then I felt as if I was about to smother, as if someone were putting a pillow over my head. Then in the morning, when I did awaken, there was a funny taste in my mouth. And there was Dan with the cover all wrapped about him. And when the doctor came, he said he was dead.
Now, you must try to control your emotions and help us to find the man that murdered your husband. Did you recognize this person?
No, sir, I couldn't keep my eyes open.
What kind of a hat did he have on?
I don't know, sir, but I think it was a slouched hat. And his coat collar was turned up about his neck.
Then you did see him?
No, sir, I did not see him. But somehow the shadowy figure of a man coming through that doorway sticks in my mind.
What time was that?
I don't know, sir. Surely you don't think I could have done it.
Lady, I'm not paid to think. Our job is finding out.
Is browbeating defenseless women a part of your job?
What's your name, son?
Buster, sir. Buster Barnett.
Well, Buster, where were you last night?
I went for a walk.
Oh, you went for a walk, huh? What time did you get home?
He didn't come home at all, Sergeant. But I know he didn't do anything wrong.
All mothers feel just like that.
I didn't do anything, Sarge. Where did you get that Hindu that was here last night?
Hindu? What are you talking about?
That fellow that calls himself the great Prince Alihabad. I guess he didn't tell you about the prince because she fell in love with him. I heard them last night planning to get married. He wanted her to go away with him this morning because Mr. Wilson told him that Margaret had come into a lot of oil land when she married. Mr. Wilson also told him that some oil company down in Shrewsport had offered a lot of money for the lease.
So you sneaked in and took the deed to make it look like the Hindu took it. Isn't that the way it was? You didn't mean to kill him, did you, Buster? You just wanted to keep him asleep long enough that you could sneak in and get the deed out of the drawer. You were very careful to use gloves, weren't you, Buster, so there'd be no fingerprints. You were very careful, weren't you, Buster? You didn't know that Mr. Wilson had heart trouble, did you? You didn't know that when he started resisting the drug, he'd get tangled up in the sheets and strangle himself. You didn't know that would turn out that way, did you, Buster?
No, I didn't do it, Sarge. I didn't do it. I was mad. I wanted to kill that Hindu, but I didn't. I went walking, but I didn't kill nobody. You know I didn't do it. You know I didn't. I didn't do it.
or any reports issued. Leave a uniformed man on guard to see that nothing's disturbed.
The chief said he wanted to compare notes with all us detectives.
Yeah, I heard him. What you gonna show him?
Well, I thought we'd just show him your book.
Well, I don't think he'd be interested in what I found. How about you?
Well, I'd like to kind of keep mine secret.
Yeah, I've been giving you a chance to get on a dope, and what do you get?
Well, now, that's different. I didn't know this was a dope case. Who used it?
Not that kind of dope. Let's go in and get something quick.
You go ahead. I'll wait.
Don't be so scared. That man can't hurt you. Come on.
I know he can't hurt me, but he can make me hurt myself.
You're the most superstitious man I ever saw.
I ain't superstitious. I'm just careful.
I'm glad that's over with. Now maybe you can keep your mind on these clues.
Hope they took everything with
them. Sure they took everything. Didn't you see them remove the mortal remains?
What I'm worrying about now is the mortal remains.
Ain't you found no clues yet?
Yeah. I found some prints over there. Look. Over there.
They're prints all right, but what kind? They look like cat tracks to me.
Whatever they are, I'm going to follow them. You know, that could have been one of them war cats.
You mean werewolf?
Whatever it was, it went under the bed. You better go under and investigate.
You go under. I'll sit here on the bed and figure out what happened.
Please don't go to sleep. And don't leave till you give me due notice.
I'll be right here when you come out. Langley. Oh, Langley. You suppose Mr. Wilson was laying down when it happened?
I guess he was. He was asleep.
That's what I figured.
You're the only one I know who can sleep standing up. mind. Who's got who up there?
I got the butler. Come on. Hurry. Come on. Langley.
Here, here. What's going on here? Hey, you get off of that bed.
It's just like I said. They're jealous of me and you. Afraid we solved the crime. That's all.
I got it, partner. I got a great idea. Come on over here and sit down. Now listen, where would you go if you had that gene?
Who, me? With all them police after me, I'd go crazy.
Don't get excited. You ain't the murderer.
I know I ain't. But just the thought of the hot seat just waiting for the man that got the deed runs my temperature well.
There's only one place for the murderer to go.
Where?
Somewhere to sell the deed. Buster said a large oil company in Freeport wanted to buy the lease off Mr. Wilson. Doesn't mean you go there.
That's a good idea. You think we'll get him down there?
Sure. All we got to do is keep our mouth shut and our eyes open.
Now, that's right. We got to stay awake on this job.
That ain't all. As soon as we get there, we got to disguise ourselves so no one knows.
We'll go right to the oil company's office and tell the president what we're after. Then if anyone comes in trying to sell a deed, we'll grab them.
That's right. Grab him. Put the handcuffs on him. Get his fingerprints. Grab who? The president?
No, we can't arrest the president. Grab the man that got the deed.
You think we ought to run up and grab him or just kind of surround him?
Sure, you grab him and I'll put the cuffs on. I'll meet you as soon as we get the thing.
Okay, we'll need the car. Well, let's drive. Don't tell a soul where we're going.
You can tell me. Silent as a mummy. I want to see the president.
Would you like to make an investment? Oil. Invest in the West.
Think you got something there.
Come on, Langley.
I was just getting a little information.
Hurry up. The man's waiting for us.
Well, give me some of that oil.
Come in, gentlemen. I'm Mr. Mason, president of the oil company.
My name's Lightfoot, and this is Mr. Langley. Glad to know you, Mr. Mason.
We're detectives.
Oh, is that so? Have a seat.
Thank you.
What can I do for you?
Mr. Mason, do you buy leases on oil land?
Well, yes. If the lease is in a producing field, a proven structure, you have one to offer?
Do you know a Mr. Dan Wilson who owns land around here?
Wilson? Yes, I know him.
He owns this tract. Very good land. We've been at that lease for some time. He's held out against us for some time. Said he wasn't ready to develop yet. Don't tell me he's willing to talk terms.
Mr. Wilson was murdered night before last. The deed to that property was stolen. We were working on the case, and we thought that... And so we came down here to look around.
I think you're 100% right. Being the largest operators in that field, he no doubt will try and interest us first.
That's what we thought.
Perhaps we better notify the local police so they can cooperate. Get me police headquarters, please. Have you any description of this man?
Nobody knows who did it.
Hello. May I speak with the chief? This is Mason, John Mason. Fine, thank you. Chief, we have a reason to believe that a man suspected of murder will bring a stolen deed here to sell. Oxley, Oklahoma. They have two private detectives in my office now. All right. Thank you, Chief. The chief will detail a man up here for a couple of days. In the meantime, you'll get in touch with Oxley.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mason. That's a great help. You won't have a thing to worry about if your man shows up here.
Well, I guess our man decided not to come this way after all. Been here 3 days now, no sign of him.
Well, no criminal with an ounce of brains would come to the one place where he's expected.
No man with an ounce of brains would be a criminal.
Well, I guess it all adds up to that anyway. You won't need to stay. I'll be busy here for sundown yet.
Work pretty late, don't you?
Well, we have to drill 3 offsets in the next 30 days. It takes work to get crew on the leases.
Yes, I heard you have some pretty good producing wells now.
Well, we have 2 on the pump. 3 wells came in on the joint lease near our line. We have to fill offset holes to protect our lease and our investment.
That's all Greek to me. I guess I'll run along and report now.
Call me up in the morning before you come up. I may not need you. Good night.
Okay, Mr. Mason. Good night.
Now, where did he go? Here we are, up another blind alley. You've been trailing everybody in town.
Book says everybody's a suspect.
We've walked this livelong day trailing folks. We followed 2 railroad men to the roundhouse. 3 different times we followed men to the levee. Now we've been following this guy since we first saw him down by the railroad yard this afternoon. I'm tired. My head aches. My back aches. I'm hungry. My feet hurt, and I ain't going no further.
Wait a minute. You can't quit now.
That part of this expedition is history. I have resigned, capitulated, abdicated, and everything else it means I'm through.
Ain't this the building the oil company's in?
You're right. This is it.
What are we going to do now?
We got to find a policeman. Come on.
But my dear man, we don't keep that much money in the office. Deals like that usually go through our bank.
None of that bank stuff. I want cash, and I want it now. Open that safe. Or maybe you'd rather I'd...
I guess another murder wouldn't mean much to you.
Stop stalling. Open that safe. I wouldn't do it, mister. What about that crack about another murder?
Nothing much. One of the men you stole that deed from is dead.
Dead? I guess that's all right. One more won't make much difference.
Drop that knife. Keep your hands up. On his wrist.
I thought you went home a while ago.
No, I had a hunch to stick around. A railroad dick, friend of mine, told me this guy got off the Oklahoma train this afternoon. So when I saw those 2 private detectives rush out of the building in such a hurry, I decided to stick around and take a look.
I'm glad you followed your hunch. You get your reward later.
Now, what's this you've been telling me about a murder going on?
It just ain't happened yet, I guess.
That's him, officer, the one there.
You mean one with the handcuffs on?
Go on, Langley, and grab it.
You do your duty now, and I'll assist you.
What are you fellows afraid of? His handcuffs?
If you shoot them handcuffs on tight, I'll go rest it.
Well, I guess you won't need me any longer. I'll go ring in.
Come on, Langley. You under arrest.
Again? Yes, again, and don't start nothing.
We'll take him on to headquarters, wire Oxley, and then turn him over to you officially. Hello, Mr. Lingley. Congratulations. Nice grab that boy of yours made. Fine work.
Just a case of civil deduction, Sergeant. That boy's going to be a great detective someday.
He's great now.
Sure, I know, dear. But maybe you'll let me do more for him now.
I was just going to tell you that our two great detectives, Lingley and Lightfoot, have captured the murderer in a neighboring state. According to latest reports, they will return with the prisoner within the next hour. In making our investigations, some very important questions arose that should be answered. Prince Alihabad, you may refuse to answer these questions if you wish.
What do I have to hide?
I wonder. Tell us, what is your right name?
Sergeant, here's your murderer.
Gentlemen, you're what I call two first-class detectives. Take this man away and have him booked for murder in the morning. Well, boys, congratulations.
All right.
A fine piece of
work. It was a tough assignment, but
business. That's another point we differ on.
What would happen should we agree?
I'd be wrong. Hey, Sergeant, don't you want this fellow to answer your question before he leaves?
That's a good idea, Buster. Well, Mr. Alihabad, we're waiting.
I am Prince Alihabad of the Royal House of Conforn.
Prince Alihabad of the Royal House of Conforn. This is really a pleasure. Now, Sergeant, you can put me in jail.
That ain't murder, son. I'm on my homicide details.
Just seen one of the most significant films made during the 1930s and 40s. This film exemplifies the culture and history of those times. Here are the other films in the Tyler, Texas Black Film Collection. Thank you. To the casual observer, it was just another warehouse in Tyler, Texas. But inside that warehouse, a vibrant world of the 1930s and 40s waited to come alive again. On a warm August night in 1983, that fascinating world was rediscovered by Dr. G. William Jones, Southern Methodist University professor and director of the Southwest Film Video Archives. After receiving a tip from the warehouse manager, Dr. Jones went to the old building. There, in a dusty, forgotten corner, he found a stack of aging steel film canisters. Inside was the missing link to black cinema. Scores of priceless nitrate prints of vintage black audience films. Together, these precious relics became known as the Tyler, Texas Black Film Collection. Why should this collection be given such a noble place in the annals of filmmaking? Why is it referred to as the missing link in black cinema? Because it comprises a major portion of the surviving films created by blacks themselves for black audiences. There were black directors, producers, screenwriters, black actors and actresses, all in control of their own destiny, telling their stories as they saw fit. At the same time, there was a whole network of theaters across the nation which showed black films on an exclusive basis. While there were various other films with all black casts, these other films were produced by white filmmakers made to please white audiences. At their best, they were mere parodies of the black experience of that time. The assorted shorts, newsreels, and feature-length films found in the Tyler, Texas Black Film Collection were in various stages of deterioration. Some were beyond repair. Through the help of the Zale Corporation, the films which were salvageable have been preserved for all the world to see. These films will provide you with a glimpse of American film history that you may never have seen before. You will be treated to a special interpretation of life during the times of the 1930s and 40s. And naturally, many of the scenes here depicted will not reflect current ideas and thinking. Yet they are extremely valuable as a gauge of a black culture still in its early stages of development. They show us a rich, complex, and unique history which belongs to us all. It has been said that we must know where we have come from in order to know where we are capable of going. So, as you watch Step and Fetch It make an art out of indecision, or July Jones dance with that distinctive flair so peculiar to that extraordinary period, remember these performers and their contributions in the context of the times, the laughter, and above all, the hope they brought to a people left behind. Rather than something to be ridiculed or belittled, these films deserve to be studied, understood, and cherished. With that in mind, sit back and relive some of the forgotten pages of a remarkable chapter in black entertainment. It's a story that begs to be told. Now, from the Tyler, Texas Black Film Collection, our special presentation.
Yeah, I'm waiting for a telegram. They promised to send me a telegram about a job. I've got to have a job. If I don't get that telegram soon, I'll die from starvation. Yeah, I'm an actor, an artist, but I've got to have something to inspire me. And nothing inspires me better than a job. Broadway. Hollywood. That's the place to be. Lots of actors and actresses are doing okay in Hollywood. Why, there's one, the queen of tragedy. She's been there for years, and she's still carrying on great. Maybe you remember a few years ago, she did a little thing like this. Peter! Peter! Give me the letter. You've had it long enough. And if you don't know what it means by now, I'll tell you. You see, the letter means that I was in love with Philip. Morris, we'd been in love for years. We used to meet one another constantly once or twice a week. Oh, each time I'd meet him, I hated myself, and yet I lived for the moment when I'd see him again. Oh, it was horrible, do you hear? Horrible, horrible, horrible. I was like the one who was possessed of some loathsome disease and who didn't want to get well. Well, then there came a time about a year ago when he changed toward me. Oh, I was frantic. I didn't know what was the matter. I made scenes. I threw myself at his feet. At last, I heard about that other woman. But I couldn't believe it. I wouldn't believe it until one day I saw her. I saw her walking down the street. Oh, she was horrible. She was all made up and covered with spangles and bracelets. And she had a wooden leg. But I couldn't give him up. So I sent for him. You read the letter. Well, he came to see me, and I told him I'd heard about that other woman. At first, he denied it. I was furious. I hated him because he made me despise myself. I cursed him out. I was beside myself. At last, he turned on me. He said it was true about the other woman, that he was glad I knew because now perhaps I'd leave him alone. But he got up to go, and I knew if he walked out the door, I'd never see him again. So I ran to the desk, and I grabbed the knife. I rushed toward him. He grabbed me, and we struggled. And we struggled until finally I dropped the knife. I had to, you see, because he'd broken my arm. But I had another arm left, and I rushed back to the desk and grabbed the revolver. I turned and I fired. I heard a scream, and I knew I'd hit him. He lurched out onto the veranda, and I followed and fired. And fired. And fired. Ugh, until there was nothing left to shoot. And so you see, that's the true story. That's what really happened, and I don't deserve to live. And now for something on the lighter side, a song by Miss Jo Forte.
Yes, I love my daddy, but I've got to have my fun. And I start out walking when he goes on his run. You tell all my men don't come around to play. You tell all my men don't come around to play. 'Cause the man back on today. You know he's weak for me, says I'm so nice. Yes, he's weak for me, says I'm so nice. You tell all the gang the coast is clear next week. Cause I know you'll soon be leaving, and it makes me wanna cry. You see, I've got his number, and he loves the song I sing. And I scream and I holler, Daddy, and he feels just like a king. Yes, I love my daddy, but I've got to have my fun. Yes, I love my daddy, but I've got to have my fun. And I scream and holler when he goes on his run.
Okay, guys and gals, didn't I tell you the kid was wonderful? Let's give another big hand for Joe. Come on. But now we've got something else that's really going to pick you up and put you in a groove. A little gal that's got plenty on the ball, little Audrey.
Learn to groove like a movie, get to be a smoothie, it's more on the side. name and give her a name that's not on the solid side. Some cats need a fine brass frame to make them scream and feel no pain. But I prefer a melody that begins in A flat and ends on high C. Maybe it's a riding swing boy, re-bop and bebop and jive. Though it's not sentimental over the gentle, it's more on the solid side. Some cats need a fine brass frame to make them scream and to feel no pain. But I prefer a melody that begins in A flat and ends on high C. Magic seems to ride and swing, boy. Rebop and bebop and jive. Though it's not sentimental over the gentle, it's more